So for next, I would like to invite Regina to talk about AI product for women. Yeah. Thank you, Regina.
So hi everyone, I'm Regina Zhang and I'm here today with my co-founder Sarah Feldman. We have a third co-founder, Kevin Flanagan, and unfortunately he can't be with us today because of personal reasons. But the three of us together make up Dialoggers. And so what really inspired our talk here today was the famous quote by Arthur C. Clarke, "Sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic." But our question was, well, not magic. Can it exist for women when the most prominent recent inventions in AI have predominantly been made by men for men? Now, why would I think that? Well, I only really need to reach into my pocket and look at some of the AI closest to my body every day to think that. Siri is perhaps the personification of the silent, submissive woman doing administrative tasks existing to please men.
Hey Siri, you're the best.
Thanks, Mr. Big, bald and beautiful.
I love you too.
And it only gets worse. Who can forget Microsoft's famous AI teenage Twitter chatbot, Tay, who learned from interactions within hours of being released. Tay started to tweet sexist, racist, and homophobic messages to her followers, leading to Microsoft giving her a permanent timeout, and she became she who must not be named. Of course, Microsoft's experience is not unique. When IBM Watson tried to learn from Urban Dictionary, they had similar outcomes. The creators of these products were clearly only considering situations where people would feed Tay and Watson data with goodwill, but it turns out that reality was far more sinister. The problem is perhaps not the tech itself, because let's face it, that's pretty dumb, but rather the human behavior it learns from. It's not a new idea that technology can amplify certain biases that humans have. Algorithms can unwittingly introduce the potential for bias, such as in the case of Tay, when they were clearly using some sort of reinforcement, time-weighted model that was ultimately gained by a section of society. But let's face it, it could have been equally possible that they were simply reflecting biases in society itself. It would probably be wrong for me to stand here and evangelize a certain model and way to mitigate this, because let's face it, we all work on different problems with different models and different data, which all require different and unique solutions. What I would say though is that we as creators should clearly be learning from these examples. We need to understand that the models we use have risk, and we need to be able to think about, well, in these cases, how are we going to create our models to mitigate biases like these? And clearly, there needs to be the option for human manual intervention should things like this happen. Of course, the examples of Siri and Tay are not positive, but they also don't have a huge impact. After all, Siri was only speaking with 11% of iPhone users last year, and Tay was more of a 16-hour experiment. But the truth is that the biases they amplify can have more serious consequences in society. How many of the women here have looked at a job ad the past 5 years? Well, unfortunately for us, Carnegie Mellon University finds that we are far less likely to see the ads for prestigious jobs, the jobs we want and deserve. Similarly, researchers at DeMonfort University found that HR chatbots favors names that are male and white sounding. And the problem of gender bias is not new or unique to AI. Who can forget that when the seatbelt was created, it was first only tested on male dummies, meaning that they only created the top part of the seatbelt and not the bottom, with fatal consequence for women. A solution to this problem is that we say that we need more women working on these products. Yes, we do. But our question is that enough? After all, in the case of Tay, the team at Microsoft boasted women inclusion in her creation. We don't know how many or what type of positions they have, but still, they were involved in her creation. Clearly, having women involved in creating our products is a good beginning, but not the end. The problem is that the step after having women involved is a little bit harder to figure out. So Sarah, Kevin, and I were thinking about this, and we decided to dial back and just ask, well, what makes good AI? We found that truly good AI just gets out of the way. It's ubiquitous, unnoticeable, and most importantly, reliable. A common example is that we've all been on an airplane and benefited without knowing from one of the first pieces of AI, which was an engine behavior prediction and monitoring by Rolls-Royce. These days, engines rarely fail because of an implementation of AgentNets to monitor aircraft engines in real time, which even recommends swapping out engines with explanations for why and where the problem is. Similarly, the Met Police, the forensic lab service, has been using AgentNets for almost 20 years, particularly in complex cases with large amounts of circumstantial evidence, to identify weak areas or areas that they should gather more evidence for, or if they need to switch focus. Unnoticeable, ubiquitous, and taken for granted, yet we all benefit from a safer society. Lastly, we can forget that Google Duplex presentation from 2 weeks ago, when it seemed like the business on the other end of the phone conversation had no idea what was talking to the machine. Yet everyone involved seemed to benefit. But at the same time, my co-founders and I could not help but wonder, Google is a powerhouse that can work on any AI problem it could choose, yet it chose to work on phone conversations. Why? Could it perhaps be because of the biggest data sets of spoken word that we have today is of phone conversations from men to women working on switchboards? Or could it perhaps be because phone conversations very, very conveniently have clear turn taking, so it makes it easier for us to do? Well, I mean, clearly none of us work at Google, so we'll never know. But I think the lesson we took away from that is that in communities like ours, well, soon we're going to face a new problem because there's only so much that we can do with existing voice data, which focuses on phone conversations and red text. And who wants to be creating products that has to compete directly with Google? The truth is that our communities, we will have to gather data from scratch to solve the problems in society that there are no solutions or data sets for today. And then the question is, well, what should we be working on? Well, I'm clearly not going to tell you what you should be working on. But what I would encourage is that as we have to work on to create the next generation of products, that we don't forget the one half of our population that consists of women, and that we have particular problems that are unique to us. Let's not forget about the experience of childbirth, periods, or even rape, because women need technology that works for us too. So what I would encourage also is that we gather data to create those products that have the voices of both women and men. Why is this important, you might ask, when we can still create products with voice data sets that are dominated by men? The products, we can make them appear, right? Well, who can forget Hello Barbie? The Barbie by Mattel, who was supposed to be able to speak to girls aged 6 to 12. How unfortunate was it that she was able to understand when an adult man was speaking to her, but not when a young girl would say things to her, because we don't have data for that demographic. So that was the background that my co-founders and I found ourselves in when we were thinking about what to make. And based on that, we felt that we wanted to make a product that also suited women by having women involved in its creation, that solved a problem that also concerned women, and by having data sets that also include the voice of women. And of course, our AI needs to be able to manage bias.
So I'm going to talk a bit more about who we are, and what we do, and how we got here. So last October, our team met in the Zinc Accelerator, which is a social impact accelerator going on here in London. And we were focused, we had to build technology businesses that had one common social mission, and that was to improve the mental and emotional well-being of women and girls in the developed world. So, we looked at how technology is used for mental health today, and you might recognize some of these businesses. I'm a psychotherapist, and I've worked in the mental health field for over 10 years, and I've actually worked for, or worked with some of these businesses. So we have all of this technology working in mental health, but somehow we still have a mental health epidemic and no end in sight. So this is our company, Dialoggers. And this is our team. So there's me, and I'm a lecturer and psychotherapist, and I'm from the US, you might have guessed from my accent. I came all the way over here for the program because I'm really passionate about mental health. This is Kevin. Kevin is not here today, but he's our tech person. He's been working in tech for 40 years. He's also a serial entrepreneur, and he used to be a trader. He's an expert in AI. And then there's Regina, who you guys just met, and she is training as a therapist, and she also has a background in research and business. So what actually we had in common, because we sound quite different, right? We're different ages. There's a 30-year age gap between Regina and Kevin. We come from different countries. We are all in different phases of life. But one thing that unified us was this feeling and this sense and this passion too, that mental health as it is, mental health industry as it is not working, and that we need other solutions. And I have been in both sides of the therapy room, and I have experienced burnout as a therapist, and I've also really struggled, as I said, developing therapists into the industry, knowing that the industry is as negligent to the therapist as it is to the clients that we're supposed to treat. Kevin, who you guys saw earlier, his daughter has struggled with depression. He has tried really hard to get her treatment that works. And in that process of her trying to get treatment, she actually got medication that made her symptoms worse and made her suicidal. Regina has struggled because she watched her mother go in and out of mental institutions and different kinds of therapy without any kind of sustainable solution. So we're all really passionate about bringing good mental health care that actually works. So, treatment as usual doesn't work. So, we went to the research and we found that what we thought was true was supported by statistics. So, over 40% of people with mental distress in the US and the UK cannot access treatment. And of the ones who can, if you look at a common condition like depression here, you can see that one-third of people don't respond to treatment. And as you move around the spectrum of mental health, it doesn't look much better. So we knew in thinking about the product that we were going to design, that if we were going to be able to solve this problem, our product had to be suitable for women. Because mental distress is something women report more frequently than men. So 1 in 3 women and 1 in 5 men. And that self-report, so we can't necessarily take that to be the reality, but that's the way that people are reporting it now. So we needed a product that clearly works for women, but not just female clients, because 85% of practitioners are female who work in this industry, and this industry has the highest burnout rate of any industry. So from the beginning, we knew we had to create a product that suited both clients and practitioners if it was going to be successful. And this was thanks to lessons from history about what makes successful medical intervention. So you may or may not recognize the men here, but we have Semmelweis, Williamson, Long, and Lister, and they each invented and demonstrated a major medical advance. Semmelweis discovered a corroded hand washing as a simple but effective way to stop cross-infection, and that was in 1847. Williamson, Long invented and demonstrated the first use of anesthesia in Boston in October of 1846. and Lister demonstrated the first effective use of antiseptics in 1865. However, what many people do not know is that only one of these were truly successful in terms of spreading around the world. So, anesthesia only took 3 months to travel around the world, to Europe, and on to as far as Tasmania. And I can tell you from visiting and working in hospitals all over the world, it's still a struggle to get doctors to wash their hands in between patients. It was more than 50 years before Joseph Lister's recommendations were adopted in the developed world, while still there are problems with adoption in the less developed world. So why has it been so difficult to spread these? To spread two of these while the other spreads so easily? Hand washing is an extra step that takes time for doctors. And antiseptics are abrasive and they burn people's skin. But anesthesia makes operating much more pleasant for doctors and patients alike. The patients aren't feeling the pain and the medical professionals don't have to endure their writhing and screaming. So the lesson that we took from this was that if we want therapists to adopt our technology, we have to make their lives easier too. So if the problem we are solving for is that therapy doesn't work today, to solve that problem, we had to think about what happens inside a therapy session. So, I'm a therapist. And sometimes even strangers think I can do a complete analysis and understand all their mommy and daddy issues and have a complete diagnosis by just giving them a party for a few minutes. So you can imagine what my clients might think. But the reality is that that's not true. And I've studied different approaches and used them with different clients and sometimes been supervised. But when the door to the therapy, when the door to the therapy room closes, there's no one to provide feedback on how I'm applying the theory to the real life situations. So in this environment, we thought, why not allow the therapist to continue to learn and develop and give them tools to better follow proven methodologies using technology? To make something like that, we need data. And as we mentioned earlier, the first challenge many of us face in making new things is gathering data. And not just data, data with female participation. We are currently seeing a wave of products that fulfill all of our criteria on some level. So Duplex, which makes life easier for both men and women, and Roomba, which simplifies the traditionally more female task of vacuuming. But as you can see, any one of us who wants to make products like these needs to embrace patients. So the way we gather data is by having a therapy business, which will allow us to create a defensible corpus of spoken dialogue where we have strong female participation. We then use NLP to capture how closely what happens in the room adheres to the theory, with the goal to provide nudges to both therapists and clients to help them improve their behavior. Because whether you have a good therapy session or don't, doesn't just depend on the therapist, but also on the client. And so that way, we have a product that benefits both clients and therapists that is unnoticeable by not providing any output until after the session is over. And as you have more sessions over time, you're only going to become better and better. So the ubiquity of our products is perhaps thanks to the therapeutic model that we utilize. It's a Scandinavian model, and it's proven to have superior results compared to treatment as usual here in the UK, across the spectrum. So across the spectrum of mental health, whether that's what we feel in everyday life, like workplace stress or heartbreak, all the way to the less common and potentially more distressing issues like psychosis and schizophrenia. The real advantage of doing something like this the hard way, evaluating the ins and outs of what makes a good product, ubiquitous appeal is that it puts you on a hard and complicated path to create a defensible product in a world where most founders and investors are looking for quick satisfaction that can be duplicated. And that allows us to capture aspects of natural conversation in our data, which is yet to exist, as most data is read text or phone conversations. So this includes silences in natural conversation and voice stressors. So hopefully, we can use that's benefit populations such as women, who unfortunately benefit less from a large amount of technology today compared to their male counterparts. So we're a group of women and men, creating products for women and men, where women make up a majority of our clients. you would be to keep us, the women, over half the world's population in mind when you create products, because we want to participate and we want to benefit equally from technology. We want to see prestigious job ads. We want to be treated equally by HR bots, and we certainly need the same amount of safety in cars. And if you're willing to take the long and complicated road to prioritize building the products that will solve some of the world's biggest problems that there is no data for yet, we encourage you not to forget that there are problems that are unique to us women, and that we desperately need technology that will help us with too.